filmmaking takes me out of my everyday life and puts me into the realm of my some kind of a life that's not every day. Although I do live my stories. That's what's a I do live my stories, in that I have a either experience or I have a strong feeling, and I have to get it out on film. And I just exaggerated a little. We have a whole assortment of films tonight that I selected together with Tony Revo. And the first picture is called Hold Me While I'm Naked. Hold Me While I'm Naked was my most popular film. It was the only film that I was ever recognized in the Bronx on the street because of that picture, because it played at the, it was a rock and roll club for a long time. And the teenagers in the Bronx used to go to that club.
You're scared. You gotta get away. You have to run. This is it. Your life's at stake. Keep running. Put one foot in front of the other and just keep going. This is your greatest portrayal. You're a star. This is gonna be your biggest picture. Keep running.
So, Hold Me While I'm Naked was a film about myself, starring me, simply for the reason that my main star became very sick during the making of the picture. And I could no longer photograph her in the plot that I had planned. And since the plot was sort of a lurid, tasteless kind of drama about a mother and daughter in conflict over the same man, it didn't matter. In fact, I was lucky. So, Hold Me While I'm Naked turned out, I focused the camera on myself and played a filmmaker, not being able to get his project off the ground. While I'm Naked struck a chord in the audience, and I think they felt the way I did about it. Wasn't only about not being make a picture, but the fact that people were having more fun, you know, the feeling that people are having more fun than you are and living it up and stuff.
Thank you.
I made Home While I'm Naked. I was making films for years before, but they were never taken that seriously. I would send in articles to film magazines, and they were rejected. But then Home While I'm Naked came out, and I got more critical acclaim. This was in 1966. Then sort of the spotlight was on me for a period of time. And from then on, people followed my career. But I'm supposed to be washed up. I was supposed to have been washed up in the 60s. And occasionally you might read a review in a New York paper that says, whatever happened to him? And they usually say it's a talent. It's so much talent gone down the drain after all these years. So, but that was the first part, and it turned out to be like a trilogy. Because I had myself in the picture, and there were all these trilogies coming out. And Antonioni was coming out with trilogies. Sajid Ray was making these trilogy movies, so I wanted to make one. So I put myself in another picture, which you'll see, called Eclipse of the Sun Virgin. Eclipse of the Sun Virgin hit more closer to home. And some of you may realize it, those who know me, that it came close to home. So therefore, I had to change it. I had to make it sort of ambiguous and have the plot line more like a dream, so it doesn't tell that much.
Achieve with your strong sexual images?
Well, making a picture is kind of hard, and if you can't get a little pleasure out of it, it doesn't seem like much worth of why should you make it. So it's a strange thing. You get with your camera and you get with a lot of people, and things come out of your head, and of course they go right into the picture. And what comes out of your head is sometimes from the fleshy part, and it's enjoyable to not only watch, but to direct scenes and help performers do kind of provocative routines. They also, of course, it comes out of your life. If you like all that sexy stuff in a picture, you just put it in a picture and you can't help yourself. You may try for something else, but it'll eventually expose you for what you really are.
Try and start this all over, huh? Look, I've got a new picture coming up, and it's got a great, great part in it. Nothing like you've been doing. None of the crap.
I don't want a director. I want a man.
Who, like Pierre tonight?
A man. Pierre.
Yeah. All right, cut. That was good. All right, we got good scenes there. Yeah, that was good. I like that very much. Now, this thing, we're going to get a close-up. Let's get a close-up on the two of them. And this one, you're saying, you know, I've got a problem, a drinking problem. The tension on the set gets unbearable. I need help. I need some kind of help. And you're kissing your neck. You say, I can help you. I can have you put away just for a while. Like, I don't like it. All right, but it's not like you're really interested in it. Okay. You say, like, trust me, I'll help you, really. I have some money. I know a place where you can go. A nice place. Some place that there's rest and relaxation, nice, decent people. Then we're gonna show where you put her, all right? You got the general idea?
How's it coming?
Well, cut down a light.
Yes, we gotta open it up to 2-8 now.
If you drive the other way,
you know you have the base here.
Okay.
Is that okay? Last time we did, yeah.
What's that you're doing, George?
So we're putting the cloth here, which is our diffusion, sort of our diffusion effect. Now, it sort of tilts our rubbers in, but maybe that won't show. You know what we'll have? We'll have him focus on the bed, so he'll just put her down on the bed. We don't even have to show them, yeah. You get the bed in there. Almost like the same shot we had last time, but just more of the bed. Frame it so the bed looks good. And you focus right on the middle of the bed. So remember, the sounds, they're very animalistic.
I say action now. Action.
Oh, Sarah.
Reach your arms up, Sherry. Reach your arms up, Sherry. That's all right. Keep on doing it. Reach your arms. Pull that purple, Sherry. Grab that purple. Pull it toward you. All right, now stick your legs up, Sherry. Now, what's some sound? Say, it's a dream. It's just a dream. Oh, my God.
Finished. All right, let's clean up. That was a very good scene. I think it'll be one of the big major scenes in the picture.
Close yourself.
Very good. All right, we're all done. That was it. All right, we clean up. Yeah, excellent performance. Yeah, all right, we'll clean up and then that's it.
Let's break it down.
Yeah. All right, now we'll see how it goes. Right? Hi, how are you? Fine. Okay. We'll put our light meter away and we'll strip the set. Strip that set. Let me get out of here. I'm going to the bathroom.
You can't help what you're doing a lot of times, especially this type of filmmaking. And you wouldn't want to stop what you're doing either, because it feels too good. That's all I'm not doing. Here we are, it's Saturday, and we're in my apartment in the Mission District of San Francisco, where I've lived now for about a year and a half. I'm surrounded pretty much by props that I've gotten from my movies and also on my travels. I've been to Europe, but not that often, as I feel comfortable here in the States, as I know where to go to escape, and I like the weather here in the States. But around me are the stuff I collected, such as this lamp was given to me by cast and crew of Sparkle's Tavern, a picture that I worked on that has not yet been released. And on it is a button, which is from my fan club. The fan club is located in Madison, Wisconsin. And here we have a picture which is you can find here around the Mission area. And then way over there in the corner is something that I made which precedes the making of my film that I'm working on now about a female Sasquatch investigator. This is the mantle of my the fireplace in the place, which is actually just a gas heater. But I have objects here. This I used in my film, which I made about the UFO phenomena. And I painted it silver. And this I used in a motion picture that I made as a tribute to my dog of many years. And it was one of his... I think you could tell the scene.
Well, Bonkum, pretty soon it'll be nighttime. I'll go to sleep. We got your own rubber bed, your rubber mat that you go to sleep on. Right, look, Baco, your little toy, look. What are you, spoiled? I try to make your life happy by buying you these little things. Look, Baco, the toy. I know what'll affect you. I'm gonna give him his favorite toy. Like it? He's bored. He's bored with that one. Here, this is the one you like. Yeah, little froggy. Like a little froggy? Come on, play with froggy. You want me to read you from the Enquirer, the National Enquirer? Come on.
Now, a picture, Wild Night in El Reno, is not showing tonight. It was booked previously, and there's no other print. So I brought a film, a longer film, considered one of my most controlled pictures. It's called A Reason to Live. Thank you very much. A Reason to Live was photographed in the same area that Wild Night in El Reno was photographed in. It's in black and white, and it incorporates a plot. So, and it's 20 minutes longer, 25 minutes longer. But features a whole array of talent I was using at that time.
Remember, there are three things in this world that you can do. You can do good, you can do bad, or you can do nothing. Look out there, Julia. A fog is coming to us. It will give you strength.
Now, there's other things here. This was given to me by a student of mine. It was my very first student.
I was George's first student, and when I was his first student, that was his first teaching assignment. So we really spent a lot of time next 3 or 4 years growing together. I'd already made films before I met George, but he was an enormous influence.
Chi-Chi, it's Vince. Were you sleeping?
No, darling. I was in the garden, planting vegetables.
I like you. You're natural. George has made some masterpieces that haven't been seen enough and may not be seen until after he's dead and gone, who knows. But I think the reason they're not shown so much is his own lack of interest in pushing his films, and also a lot of his, he doesn't really try to cater to an audience. He insults the audience even sometimes.
What kind of response from your audience are you really trying to get?
Just sit there. See the picture from beginning to end. Maybe go to a place that's got free coffee and a little sidelight like that, comfortable. No big deal, nothing too posh. If there's anything too posh, it makes the films look abrasive.
Mm-hmm.
And I was sometimes labeled as Kuchar Brothers. And then my brother comes up here, and his work is completely different from mine. It's a whole other personality. So the two of us are up, and it's supposed to be like Mutt and Jeff, you know? Not exactly Mutt and Jeff, he's my height, but it's like Abbott and Costello. And my brother Mike is a completely different person with a completely different aesthetic.
Doctor didn't tell me that I was going to have twins because I was very nervous. And then in my last month, the doctor told me that I was going to have twins. And I almost went out of my mind. And then when I did bring him home, I didn't know what to do with him. One year they asked me, they were about 11 or 12 years of age, they asked me if they can have a camera for their birthday. And I wasn't too keen about getting them, excuse me, I'm making a mistake, so for getting them a camera. But then there was nothing else they wanted but camera. The two of them, Ma, please. So I bought them a camera. Then I bought them the films and everything else. And they were always saying, well, it's for the two of us. I said, it costs too much money. No, Ma, please, Mommy. That's for the both of us. The two of us are going to play and all that. Well, when I bought them the camera and the rest of the equipment they played on, from that time on, there was nothing that stopped. Nothing. Every time they get their allowance and all that, they used to go buy films and make movies. But that was their hobby. And I guess it's their pleasure. And I didn't want them to become filmmakers. I wanted them to be baseball players or basketball players and all that. And I guess they didn't go in for that. So whatever they're doing now, they do them because they like it. As long as they're happy, that makes me happy.
We're on that 40. Or did you want to know anything specific?
Well,
about our career or something?
We'd like to know about you and Mike, how you got started in your Super 8 films.
Mike, I think you ought to mention that, and I think you ought to mention it was Irregular 8. That's the first thing you ought to mention.
Oh, yeah, I started making films before Super 8, to Regular 8. Then I was a present. We borrowed our aunt's camera, 8mm camera. Then we made movies and up on the roof, because we didn't have any lights. Then that was a Christmas time, came a couple years later. Then my family bought us a regular 8mm camera. And then we would make films with up on the roof. Sometimes they were costume pictures, so we used my mother's drapes and things around the house. And when she was gone to work, and usually went smoothly, except if we were spent too much time, then she'd come home from work, find the drapes missing from the window, and she'd come up on the roof and surprise us, and we all have to run away.
They really shocked me, because I wasn't home with them. I used to go to work, and I'd come home, and they'd take all my best blankets and my clothing and everything, and they used to take the chairs on the roof and take my bass silver and whatever. Glassware they're taking on the roof, and they used to take pictures and whatnot. And they used to make dummies, and they used to throw them off the roof. They'll be coming home, and the neighbors will be complaining.
Thank you.
I gotta get this ready for my Sasquatch picture.
Where's the star of the picture?
Michelle, we're all ready for you. Very good. I come in. This is Michelle. She's acting in my film. She plays a Sasquatch investigator. And she's basically, the character is basically a housewife. But the housewife is interested in the studying the Sasquatch for primal reasons, her own base primal reasons. We've already shot 11 rolls of film, which you've never seen yet. You don't want to see it, do you?
Well, I sort of do, but yeah, in a way I don't. I'm scared to.
Because it's sort of nerve-wracking?
If I see myself in my underwear or something, I might not want to do it anymore.
you look very good in the undergarments. Very German.
Oh, that's what I was afraid of.
No, you look very good. I was telling my friend that you look like a... like a hochbrow.
Oh.
But I meant to say like a hochbrow. Well, these are our photo albums here. Now, please feel free to ask any questions you want. These are some of the very earliest pictures. This was me in my youth.
Uh-huh.
I was a lot thinner then. I think I got kind of puffy.
Huh. Who's that?
She was our very first female lead.
Oh.
In those days, we didn't have that many, knew that many girls, so... The guys used to dress up as girls and alternate. So we had the male and all male cast, but female characters. This was also one of our big stars. She was never interested in being in films, but she had nothing else to do. So we'd come over with a camera, and because there was nothing else to do except eat, we'd also make a picture. Her name was Sally Roman.
New York looked a lot different then.
Yeah, it was different. It was Bubbaville.
Bubba?
Yeah, there were a lot of Bubbas and
what's
shopping.
Bubba?
A Bubba is like a Jewish grandma goes shopping and
yeah.
buys
Who's
them.
That?
That's Mike with a mustache.
That was me in school. That's how I lived in school.
And here's Barry Skolnick. He was noted for
like
he wanted to be sexy, and he was like a super macho guy, and he was one of our leading sex symbols. He had
his
shirt.
Underwear is showing.
Oh, yeah, that's the only thing. His underpants.
Oh, now this is a good picture. Which one is this?
That's me.
That's you, huh?
Yeah, that's me in my youth. This was years later when I had a job.
Oh, you guys are so handsome.
That was many years ago when I still had a lot of hair and stuff. And I wasn't that puffy, you know. But this was also me in
You were just as puffy, believe me, that you were.
In the schleppy roles.
Uh-huh.
And,
That's good, with the umbrella.
Yeah.
Like that. Now
here's when I had a job. I was doing weather maps for a company.
This looks like a cheesecake. Photo.
It's supposed to be beefcake. It's not cheesecake. It's actually a beefcake.
Beef
picture
is
my
for
brother.
The boys. And
yeah,
Jesus
that's right.
For the girls.
Yeah, that's for my brother.
That was me.
That's you.
Yeah.
I keep getting confused. Well, which one of you guys is oldest?
I am by 1 hour. All right, that's the history in review.
Well, what do you think the future holds?
Well. More weight problems.
No, I mean as far as you know, what your films, I mean, I want to know if I'm going to be
probably,
working for successful filmmakers.
Meh, I think it's just eventual obscurity, more and more obscurity. I prefer it that way.
Right.
This is sort of my section of the house. But in my room, I have it decorated as sort of a religious motif because I wanted to counteract the feelings I get from down there in the street. And I don't mind that much a religious motif, just that when you want, like, sex activity, it's sort of weird. You have to go into another room. Let's turn on this thing. And we got another one here. This one is, they're kind of expensive, these two items. They're like $30. Then I have for the more esoteric elements, the UFO detector, which should sound alarm. Hopefully it never will. At least, I think I hope it never will. Here we have a whole thing going from oil painting to other stuff I did, to a watercolor, to very bleached out work that I did. This is a watercolor I did, my most recent watercolor, 1979. Then we have a whole bunch of other things. Now you see what time did to this. Time ticks away and the pictures fade. Nocturne was a film that I made to try out a film stock, which was Ektachrome EF. It just came on the market. And I wanted to photograph the, since it was a high-speed film, I could use it at night, and I wanted it to photograph the moon coming up. So I concocted some stories to put it in between the rising of the moon. That's the message for that film.
Produce my early pictures. Whenever I needed money, my mother always loaned me the money. Did you, Ma?
I did. I never refused it.
You still do it?
I still do it. I'll do it, I guess, for the rest of my life.
It's a little bit disgrace, I know. But...
No, it isn't. Well, who's going to help you if your mother doesn't help?
Here we are at my work table. It's not actually the table that I work at. As I work all over the apartment, wherever I can. But I have stored down here my scrapbook. Now, my scrapbook is getting fat, as I've kept it for many years. And I always tell my students, keep your work, keep the reviews of all your work. Keep your work, too. But keep the reviews of all your work so that you know how the movie was received when it came out. It goes back, my scrapbook, to the very early days when I was making pictures. And in my actual 8mm period. And this was illustrated by me. That's my brother, how my brother looked many years ago. I would say like 15 years ago. And this is the way I had looked 15 years ago. Now, I wanted to illustrate this book to give it extra depth and meaning. So these were my illustrations, and this was my very first review from the New York 8mm Club. It was not a very kind review. It had said that we were in greater distress than a star on the screen during the showing of this film. Our apologies to all those who suffered with us. This was when I was in Who's Who in America. But we were taken out of Who's Who in America after a couple of years. And I think you're not supposed to. Once you're in there, you're supposed to be in there for life. But for some reason, they took us out after a couple of years. I never wrote them a letter and asked them, why did you do that? What the hell with that? This is in the file, a private dossier in the dean's office or something, because they found it objectionable. There's a little drawing here of a man on top of a woman behind a tombstone that illustrates a scene in a picture. And when these little things, they're not pamphlets because they don't fold, when it was handed out, showed this little thing, somebody zeroed in on it and said, this is obscene. Now, this is the editor of the Berkeley Barb, and this was a very good review written. Here's my actress, Donna Caness, and her husband now. And for all Donna Caness fans, she's now living in San Antonio, Texas, and working in a Fredericks of Hollywood shop. She's doing all right. Now, the book goes all the way through my career. And I like making movies very much because they record the friends that you had, the pets, and the neighborhoods you lived in. And therefore, they are like a running commentary on your life. Plus, most of the subject matter relates to what's been happening to you. All right, this is also from museums. You know, I was trained like a commercial artist in an art school, and for an artist to get into a museum was considered a big deal. You usually had to be dead. But via films, the door opened, and I managed to get into Museum of Modern Art, which I had always admired, although if you stay in there too long, you get a headache. This is a poster that was done by a boy in Europe. He's probably a young man by now. And it's a picture of the Devil's Cleavage. And he concocted this poster, and he even got together his distribution company, which he calls Respectable Films.
I don't like men in underwear. It makes me sick, do you hear me? Sick. I've never even seen Frank's underwear. You gotta believe me.
Margaret, stop. Stop before I call the highway patrol.
Here's for the Devil's Cleavage, where my picture was shown in the 9th International Berlin Film Festival. And it says, my Kuchar's Dritter Lager nach Einigen Kurzfilm in 16 millimeter ist ein Film und Gopher Zorgfig, die Reflection der Kundelfeinde.
Well, Georgie called me up one evening, and he said to me that his movie's gonna play downtown. And he says to me, Mother, if you can go, I appreciate it. He says, take one of your friends, which I called up. She used to be the twins' neighbor. I called her up and I says, Ellen, would you like to go see George's picture? She loved George. George was her favorite. So she said, fine. It played all the way downtown, but we managed to get there. And we got there. Well, they were just about to show the movie, George's picture. She says to me, is that George's? I said, I think so, I don't know. And then when she did see in the George's movie, when we were going home, she was so angry that she didn't want to talk to me. And from that time, we weren't friends, but we were the worst enemies. And that was it.
What didn't she like about the movie?
Well, it wasn't too, well, I don't know if I should say it. Well, to her, it was ugly. Like, she knew George was good and all that. Like I say, he was her favorite. And then when she saw that, she was very much disappointed. And she acted different towards me, too, which I didn't... I didn't want to be honest, which was I didn't want to see it. I didn't know what it was all about. See, to me, it was shocking, too.
And if it does rain, don't run. There's nothing like a little of God's water to wash away the dirt to collect.
The Devil's Cleavage.
He's laughing about it, but it's not funny. And I never mentioned it to their father. Because if I ever mentioned it to him, he would have thrown me out of the house, period. So I never went to see his movie again. But I love him. I don't care what he is or what he does. But I still love him.
Then we have we got to go to Thundercrack. Now, Thundercrack was a picture that I had written the screenplay for. And this was in The Advocate, which is a gay newspaper. And part of the roots of the gay picture, although it ain't really like a gay picture, but it could be. Why not?
George was going to go study tornadoes in Oklahoma again, as he does annually. And he took the basic outline for the story along with him and spent every day from 1 to 4 writing the dialogue to Thundercrack.
Thundercrack was the first film that I did with George, and that was when I first met him. And one of the reasons that I chose to say yes to doing the part is when I read the script, I was thrilled by his language, his use of words, his beautiful, long, dramatic, passionate speeches. And he reminds me a lot of Tennessee Williams. With a little Albie thrown in.
He really always wanted to be a writer, like a script writer, and an actor, and a weatherman, more than a filmmaker, I think.
Then she turned that massive pointed head toward me and bared those giant yellow teeth in a smile of affection. I screamed so loud that every creature in that circuit went wild in their pain. Maintenance men found me lying by the calliope, trying to sing I love you truly. Medusa was lying there in the sleeping bag, massaging her breast. They said it took four men from the loony bin to carry me away.
You were put under observation?
For a whole week. Then I was set free and I went back to work.
George as an actor is quite an experience for any director, and I would recommend that any director try to use him, because he's phenomenal. But he's more like a performer. He has certain abilities and a style that you really have to know about before you direct him, because he's not a traditional actor. He's not a professional actor that'll just do what you tell him. So you have to set up scenes that you know he can wreck, you know. If there's a table full of dishes, he'll make sure that he catches his arm on the, or hand on the tablecloth so that they'll spill off at some point. Or if there's something that can be thrown in your face, like a drink or something, he'll do it. What you have to do is, you have to have a camera with a wide-angle lens, and it has to be handheld so that you can follow him around and catch whatever he does. Because once he's on, once you say action, he does things that can't be repeated.
Fighting it, you only live once.
Oh, it will be a pleasure to cater to your honeymoon with bananas, bonbons, and a chase.
This is what I look like when I acted with Mary Eaton and Thundercrank. This is a picture that's kind of risque. I don't know if you should see that one.
you don't surprise me anymore, George. Because you're really full of surprise.
Marion, a lot of people want to know, who does your makeup?
Well, in George Kuchar's films, Mr. Dominique does the makeup, otherwise known as George Kuchar. In Thundercrack, was the first time that George ever made me up, and I'll never forget the first night on the set when he put the eyebrows on Gert, and I wasn't at all prepared for that. And I thought, oh, no, I'm not, is this, I had pictured the character a whole different way, and I certainly didn't see myself with those eyebrows. I was really unsure whether that was gonna work or not. I thought, oh, they're gonna have to film it all over again tomorrow night, because I look so weird.
All right, this is from Contemporary Cinema, which was part of FilmX. Now, in FilmX, I had my dream realized to go to Hollywood, and because we went down to Hollywood and we appeared at the premiere of our picture, which played at midnight, Thundercrack, at the, it's a big center. What's the name of that center in Hollywood? That Century City. And I heard that Lana Turner lives right in the Century City complex, and they have the great theater, and our picture Thundercrack played. And we went there in a black limousine. There were big lights outside, the swinging lights, which were part of the big gala premiere. But it was my dream come true, a Hollywood premiere. And I was there on a big screen, represented as an actor. And that was a wonderful time. All right, now this ain't my, this is just a record of everything that was kept. And I always tell people to send, please send reviews, either good or bad. Don't be embarrassed. Like, if the review is bad, send it anyway. I don't get that crushed. Sometimes they're personal and they can get insulting, but I don't care. You have to fill up a book. And on gray days or even blue days, when you're feeling bad, you can take out your book and it's like a third person is in here. I'm gonna scrap a... All right, then we go on to black and white film, I, an Actress.
I and Actress was the a film that I made in 10 minutes. It was the quickest film I ever made. It was in preparation for over 2 hours, 45 minutes. So it was actually to be a screen test for a girl, Barbara Lapsley. She's the actress. She was in my class, but she didn't make films, and she wanted to get credit, so she asked, since I'm an actress, how about taking a screen test of me? And I would like to get a job in the professional world. I can have this as my portfolio piece to show it to a producer. So I said, fine, and she came all dressed up and makeup on, and she looked great. She came to the studio and said, well, where's the script? I had a three-hour class. And I told her, I don't have it right now, but just wait, I'll have it. And she said, oh, George, how could you do this? I said, don't worry, I'll whip up the script. They'll just set up the lights, I'll do it. So I did it, and unfortunately, once again, it got into personal matters, because I was having some personal troubles at the time, and they crept into the script. So I achieved emotional intensity, but it's embarrassing now to view it. And then the equipment broke down. The equipment was breaking down, the sync sound camera, the tape recorder wouldn't work. So 10 minutes was left to the class. And we had 400 feet in the camera. And that 400 feet lasts 10 minutes. So this was perfect. So I just said to the cameraman, I said, listen, leave the camera running and don't turn it off. Get her up there and just run it out. That's 10 minutes, the class is over, we'll also have a film. So we did that, and then to liven things up, I came in on the set to jazz it up and interact with her. So she didn't have to work with the dead material. There was nothing but dead material around. And I, an actress, is the final result. Now, she saw the rushes and she hated it. It's all blurred. The camera tries to follow her, it misses her, because, you know, no one knew where she was going or what she was going to do. So she hated the rushes. Then she saw with sound. Years later, she saw with sound. And she said, thank you very much, George, for making this picture.
All right, and you say, and don't tell me I'm a cheat. When I cheated, it's not for sex. It's for revenge. It's to make you feel what you're doing to me, so you can wake up at 3 a.m. with a cold sweat staining the sheets. What happened, George? All right, do that. Okay. No, keep running. Keep running. Oh, everything runs. Go ahead, do it. Do the scene. Keep running.
And don't tell me I'm a cheat.
Right.
When I cheat, it's not for sex.
All right, let me say that. When I cheat,
it's not for sex.
All right, make it go like this. No, when I cheat, it's not for sex.
Oh, I can't do that, George. I'm too embarrassed.
Just try like a little bit. Like if I can.
It's not for sex.
No, you mean when I cheat, it's not for
sex. When I cheat, it's not for sex.
Drop on your knees and
darling, I need you
like
so
this.
Much.
Like, darling, I need you so much. All right, try that.
I need you so much.
Wait, put the head on. All right, try it again.
I need you.
All right, try it without
you've
the
paper. You've got to believe me. I'm a woman on my knees. Aren't you used to women on their knees, Harold, or are you used to women on their backs?
So I was very happy. She saw it and she liked it. She is up in Vancouver now and modeling for, it's like, I guess, an equivalent of Safeway. It's like a shopping thing, but she was on the cover of their food newsletter, I guess. And she was holding frozen fish cakes. Yeah, she had her thing she wheeled around. She had the frozen fish cakes. So in a way, she got a job. She got a position.
All right, now I want to direct you in this scene. So I got the light meter ready. Now, you understand the scene? Not that much, do you?
Yeah, I think I do. I'm frustrated.
Right, you're frustrated, but you still have a graciousness left over from your previous life. So when you take the spoon in your hands and put it to your mouth, I want your pinky to go up, like, daintily. Like, you mm-hmm. still have graciousness. That's right, you're getting in the mood. Mm-hmm. Let me frame you. That's right, I'm gonna leave this frame. All right, now you take a... Still, it's gracious. It could be like a fine restaurant you're in. Now, raise your head. Now put the tongue, the whole thing. Now what you've got to do is like fill up the spoon like you're having soup. Now bring it into your mouth like you're having soup. The whole thing goes in. Now swallow the whole thing. Now, all right, let me wind up.
See, I have a wind here, so I just got to wind up now. You can swallow that, and then we'll do a retake, all right? Okay. Now, there'll be several scenes of eating in this picture.
I
this
thought
is...
you wanted me to talk.
Yeah, now talk.
Before the spoon goes in my mouth.
Well, for the picture, we won't have any dialogue, but if you want to get something off your chest, go ahead and say it. But maybe we can look at some rushes. Screen those rushes now, and I'll show you what we're talking about. I sort of did a lot of cutting to piece together all the scenes. But I think it's shapely enough, and it gets across the message.
You cut like you're like a lace maker.
Well, I like to cut films. My films uncut are not that interesting. I'm not the type of filmmaker.
You're a genius at cutting.
I have fun cutting it.
Oh.
That's part of the pleasure of making a picture.
Now that's amazing. You didn't even, you know, show any ripples or anything. I was so worried that you would.
Like stretch marks?
Yeah. No. All that unattractive stuff.
No, I'm sometimes blamed for doing that, but I never do that.
I know.
I never do that.
I was worried. I was really worried. I was trying to keep my legs together and stuff.
No, spread your legs for this one.
Yeah.
Now, these colors, the colors toward the end of the picture, see, I wanted it to go, as the character, as her mental state begins to deteriorate, I wanted the colors to shift and become more unreal. That's why I did that. Now, you look very good there.
Right? I'm surprised.
I'm surprised, too, but you turn out very well in film. Some people actually have it.
Better.
Some people, Howard Hawks had said that, Lauren Bacall, she had that something that whatever she did turned out well in film. You have something.
Well,
we reach an end. We reach an end of the picture.
The lily.
Now we put sound in it. You put sound in it. We're going to have a good picture.
Terrific.
A very good picture. Yes, we got a question on this side.
What would you describe as your ideal type of film to make? If you had unlimited funds, somebody approached you with money and gave you the ability to do whatever kind of film you wanted with unlimited budget, what would you do?
I'd probably give up filmmaking because I don't think I can work under those conditions. I have to work under very strict monetary conditions. Very low budget productions as far as sets and no actors as far as any professional people. I have to start from rock bottom and I have to keep among the rock bottom crowd in order to produce my work. I think too much money and too much power will glut me and I'll automatically short circuit. And I will produce nothing. It'll be the end of my career.
Well, you guys are still doing that documentary. Everybody's still inside. Let's go inside.
But I met George Kuchar in Holland. I am from Holland, and I like his films very much, especially the way he edits the films and the way he uses the actors. And about the films I saw this evening, the one I liked the most was A Reason to Live. And I liked the female persons in it. They were very glossy-like and very female. But I keep on wondering about one thing, that is why he would always try to use parts of nature and parts of the weather in his films, and especially the film A Reason to Live. You see the fog of San Francisco rolling in, and it's supposed to heal the people, at least that's what they say in the film, but it doesn't heal at all. It only makes you more upset. And there's one sentence I liked very much in that film, A Reason to Live. That's the sentence that goes like, you can do three things, do nothing, do good, or do bad. When you do nothing, nothing will happen. And when you would start to do something, you meet with good and bad. And I think that these two things are a very big part of the films I saw till now from George Kuchar, but it's always much better than doing nothing. That's what I want to say.